All right. Hello, everybody. Welcome to another Office Hours. My name is Apoorva Ashok. I use she, her, hers pronouns, and I'm joining you all today from Toronto, which is actually on the traditional territories of many nations, including the Mississaugas of the First Credit, the Chippewa, the Anishinaabeg, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples. I'm very grateful to be living out the last days of summer, or what it feels like on this beautiful land. And I just want to note, I welcome you all to add your own territorial acknowledgements to the chat. This is just one small part of my practice and of Rebus's to support decolonization and reconciliation work in Canada. And I look forward to doing more in my role at Rebus and in my personal role where I live. A little bit about Rebus. We are a Canadian charity that helps educational institutions build human capacity in OER publishing and in open education in general through professional development. And we're excited to have partnered with the Open Education Network for the past 5 years to offer these office hour sessions. Karen will tell you a little bit more about office hours, about the OEN, and our fabulous lineup for today. So over to you, Karen.
Thank you very much, Apoorva. It is great, as always, to be here with you and Caitlin and the Rebus team. I'm Karen Lauritsen. I'm Publishing Director with the Open Education Network. We're based at the University of Minnesota. And as many of you are a part, we are a community of professionals working to make higher education more open and equitable. Office Hours, as Apoorva mentioned, has been a five-year partnership with the Rebus community. We talk informally on a monthly basis about things that are on our mind. But of course, it really helps to know what's on your mind. So please always feel free to offer suggestions for future topics. Today's topic was inspired by the reality of our lives, particularly over the last couple of years, and what we've heard from the community about burnout and fatigue and the desire to try and lean on and support one another to keep going. So we have four guests joining us today. I will introduce them briefly in a moment. After we hear from them, we will really turn to you for your questions and for you to start the conversation. Before we do that, I will let you know that I am joining you from Central California on the coast, and this is the traditional and ancestral home of the Chumash. And recently I learned about a very cool project they are currently working on with other community members and elected leaders here in California, and that is to establish the first national marine sanctuary. They started this campaign in 2013, and the nomination has just been accepted by the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. So this is something that the Chumash have been working very closely with our community on recently, and I'll just drop a link in the chat in case you're interested in learning more. So without further ado, I will let you know who's here with us today in terms of our guests. We are joined by Jess Mitchell, who is Senior Manager in Research and Design at IDRC, Lisa Petrides, who is the CEO and founder of ISKME, Angelique Carson, who is Shared Collections Librarian at the Washington Research Library Consortium, and Doug Kennedy, who's Assistant Professor, Integrative Health and Wellbeing Research Program at the Earl E. Bakken Center for Spirituality and Healing at the University of Minnesota. Now, I know I introduced some of you using acronyms, so please feel free to elaborate on those acronyms. And with that, I will hand things over to Jess.
Hey, everybody. Thanks, Karen. Thanks, Apoorva. Thanks for having this event. I think it's a great way to bring people together. You mentioned being part of a community, Karen. I'm kind of thinking that that is the way we move so much of the work forward that needs to happen. I'm on Anishinaabeg, Haudenosaunee, and Huron Wendat territory here in Southern Ontario. I'm just down the road from the Six Nations, the Grand River Reserve. And I've been spending a lot of time thinking about this little turtle island we've got here. And as I spend the time thinking about decolonization and equity, the more I read, the most recent thing that I was reading, Patriarchy Blues, Frederick Joseph, a fine read. He makes a wonderful point, which is when we do this work, we have to look to the most marginalized. It's sort of back to that, if any of us isn't free, none of us is free. And the most marginalized that he's talking about, and I think that I've been thinking about lately, are Black cis women and Black transgender women, also Indigenous women, the most precarious, the most diminished, the most leaned upon, the ones who are doing all the lifting. So I spent a lot of time thinking and trying to use whatever voice I have as an awkward ally, white person, to try to carve a space out there. I was involved in a project earlier this year, and I feel uneasy when people talk about projects that were passion projects or these sort of projects of the heart, because I don't want it to seem like some projects aren't passion projects or projects of the heart. And also, sometimes it seems to diminish the legitimacy of the project if you align yourself too closely with it using something like your big organ, your heart. We did something around humanizing learning, and we thought of that quite broadly, brought a group of people together and really wanted to create that community of practice, one where people could come and figure out what it meant to bring their whole selves, not in that way where it usually happens, where the wrong people hear it, but that way where marginalized voices can be heard. The project brought a lot of leaders together. In some cases, some might say usual suspects together in Ontario higher ed institutions. And those folks used that platform to bring in fellows. So we brought in, again, thinking, who are those who are most precarious? Who are those who are experiencing the most difficulty in general, but also specifically during the time that we were in, which was COVID year 1.5, 2. And we reached out to sessional adjunct, precariously employed faculty, graduate students, those people who are, again, doing the lifting, doing the work, and aren't resting with a safety net underneath them. And we brought them together and did some co-design sessions where we talked through a number of topics and themes that we thought were important to this work of humanizing. And I will say, when we started the project, there was very much this project mentality. What are our milestones? What are our deliverables? What are our due dates? And I actually even got a little nudge from one of the participants. He described himself as a nervous squirrel and wanted to know what we were doing. I resisted and pushed back as much as I possibly could, because I don't like having a defined path in the what we're doing. It's this very tightrope walk between having a purpose and leading the purpose rather than letting others lead it or contribute to it. So long story short, something happened in our weekly meetings. At first, the group didn't want to meet weekly. They thought it was too much. We're still meeting weekly. The project's at long ended. And what we did is we created a community. And that community really came together with our full selves. In the outcome of the project, that is the press book that we created, we have a reference to the musical Rent, and we ask, how do you measure a year? And in that year that we all spent together, a lot happened. We had deaths. We didn't have any births, but we had a couple of attempts at potty training that didn't go so well. We had brain surgeries. We had citizenship ceremonies. We had kids going through pandemic quarantines, parents juggling their own schedules and their own work spaces. And it's that stuff that we so quickly forget. We had somebody with a self-described elite level sleep apnea. So we were entangled, folks. We were situated. We were in our context. We were being human together. And we had some interesting outcomes from that I think moved this work forward. We talked about pedagogy of care. pedagogy of trauma, trauma-informed pedagogy. And I'm at this point now, I think, where I want very much to approach everybody with an expectation that you've lived a life, you've got trauma. How can we do this thing together? And how can we help lift each other up? How can we make our experiences with each other positive? And how can we do this without this kind of zero sum approach where I lift somebody else up, somebody else doesn't feel lifted up? I think that there's enough to go around. I want to focus on the most precarious because I think for hundreds of years, there's been a deep injustice. There are scars, there are wounds. Well, stop there for now. I hope I haven't killed the mood, and I'm gonna pass it on to Lisa.
All right, thank you, Jess, for really setting that context of kind of where we're all starting today, right? This is what we've been through in the last couple of years. And I want to speak a little bit in my role as CEO and founder of ISCME, the Institute for the Study of Knowledge Management and Education. Our work is about making learning and knowledge sharing participatory, equitable, and open, because we, in fact, believe that the development of equitable and inclusive learning environments contribute to the creation of a more just society. So we embed that in our mission. You might know one of our key initiatives, which is around the Digital Public Library, OER Commons. And we have several communities of practice of people who we do, basically, we help them stand up their own libraries and do their work and their professional, we help train them to do their professional development and whatnot. So we've been, all remote since March 2020. And not only really with all of these partners, helping them grapple with this move to, remote learning, all this work with like, how do we focus on the people that we serve to, how are we doing as an organization? Are we okay? I like but your list, Jess, of things, just rang true, but let me add in California, add fires to that. We had several people displaced because of fires, and it's been a rough time. So, really when I saw this topic, I was like, this do more with less kind of attitude, basically it's a scarcity model, and we need to just kind of toss it. Maybe you can do more with less for a hot minute, when you're, you've had some staff changes or there's a new project and you haven't ramped up yet. But the idea that we just need to sort of resist that and say, no, that's not possible. We can't do that. So what does that mean? It means that, first of all, that we have to just change that narrative of doing more with less and say, is it about prioritizing? How do we help each other prioritize what's most important? How do we educate to be human? What does that look like? It's interesting, even in our team meetings, of course, which changed dramatically when we were all remote, we were about half remote before the pandemic and now fully. And, part of it is just being there and showing up. I would say to people, like, you don't have to like blur the background of your screen unless you want to. You don't need to put up some, nice cheery background, like have your kid who's sick or your dogs who are providing comfort. Or I live with my mother who's 88 years old and has dementia, who can just wander into the screen and ask me how to brush her teeth. Right, it's modeling that, right, as a manager, and just saying it's okay. Let's just be here. It doesn't matter. How many people have you seen? Someone grabs a cat and says, "I'm sorry, the cat ran in front of the screen." Like, how do we just be here and be human and do our work? I think that's been such an important part of what I've tried to model as a manager, and I've certainly seen it really have an impact in the way we can sort of relax into the work, understand the work is important. It has a strong mission, but we can't get into this sort of deadly downward spiral of doing more with less, and just thinking we have to keep doing, and for what. Now, part of it, you know, specifically, I think most of us here, and those of you who are in the room with us today, you know, we're working in the space of open education. And while it's a relatively new field in some ways, I know that it can be very discouraging. You know, maybe you've been at this for a couple of years and you've seen something take hold, and then it's not working, and you're trying and you're just burning out, and you're saying, ah, and we've seen some amazing people, I think, leave the field for things that are maybe not as, I don't want to say meaningful, but don't have such a passion involved in it, or a value of social justice and change and transformation in it, because it takes too much to maintain that. I think what I've lived in, you know, we've been doing this work, or my organization and me, of course, for almost 20 years in open education. And I've seen so many things kind of come, and I've seen a lot of negativity. I've seen bad things happen. I've seen amazing things happen. I've seen transformation happen. Sort of when you start to see all the different sort of life cycles of the change, I think there's not so much of this impetus to say, it has to change now. And if it doesn't, I'm leaving, you know, and that causes us to want to just burn ourselves out, because we think we have to give it all every day. And actually what we have to do is sort of give to ourselves every day, and then just show up and do the work. And it doesn't mean that you do it with any less care or intensity. There's just, you know, there's just a sense of how you can do it. I like to say that I'm a really good plotter, and that's with a D, D-D-E-R, that you just kind of keep going and doing the next right thing. And that's really what has kind of kept me and I think our organization going and actually thriving. And you know, we've seen also too with the, you know, the Great Resignation, we've had people cycle out, you know, of our organization, and amazing people cycle in. And there is something to be said for time and age and wiseness and all that good stuff. That you do just kind of sit back and say, this is the work. Are we adjusting appropriately? Are we making the kinds of changes we need? Are we reflecting? Are we self-reflective? Are we critical of our own work and trying to do it better? As long as you're doing a little bit of those every day, that's how you show up. That's how you show up for your work. That's how you show up for life. That's how you show up for change, whether it's personal or professional. So I'm going to stop here, and I am going to pass it over to Angelique.
Thank you so much. I got some chills there, especially, you know, there is something to be said for like wisdom and age, but I'll tell you what, I'm ready to hand it over. These Gen Z kids, I love them. They're not having it, and I applaud it. Take it, please. You know, I also was really enthused about the topic for today. Everyone's been having these conversations. The Washington Research Library Consortium really had its annual meeting, and our plenary speaker spoke about morale and the ambiguity of our lives, you know, and what this means for us now, 2 years later. And she spoke about several items, but one item I walked away with, which I was surprised I'd never heard of, was professional awe. And so much of that informs what we do. And one of, and if you haven't heard of it either, it means like your work is so noble and so good that you will overservice at the, you know, risk of your own health, because the work needs to get done. And I think in a service industry with the service community that we have professional awe, you know, like, or we are likely to have it. And one of my colleagues was like, well, I've never had professional awe. And I was like, well, good for you, because that is exactly how I entered into this field. As a BIPOC librarian, my first institution was an HBCU, historically Black college and university. And I'm not wearing any wings, but if you're a librarian at a school that has historically serviced our most vulnerable populations, teaching someone how to do the most minor task will transformed their academic career in an afternoon. And you have that with you. It is a unique sense of responsibility. And I don't want to sound dramatic, but you're not just here to get a job done. You're here to get a job done for your people. And that is never not important. I love their faces in front of me, and I want to do everything for them I can on every given day, knowing how much it took them to get there. When I was a young student myself, and I was, you know, like, well, everyone's coming back to school now, of course, and I've been watching the students come back to the University of Virginia, Jefferson's University. That was my undergrad as well. When I came to UVA, I was a BIPOC student, first generation, low income. And for my first English 101 class, there was a draft we had to turn in, and I turned in my draft handwritten on paper. My high school did not have a computer lab. I had never written a paper out. I did not know that when you turned in a paper, it was typed. I remember, bless her to this day, I wish I remembered her name. The TA just graciously took my work. I think there were still spirals on the end of it where I had torn it out of my notebook. And I remember, I think, a student saying something, wow, I didn't know we could do that, and not having any idea of what they meant, you know? So how can we take care of ourselves when we are who we are in the service that expects that, and the professional awe is just, it's our standard. We are not hedge fund managers. There's a reason we're in this room together, you know? So, and when I first entered into librarianship, I was at the Southern University of New Orleans. And at the time, 40% of Louisiana state residents did not have internet access. That was about 10 years ago. I promise you it's not better right now. And I could tell you why, but that's another topic. I don't want to get upset. But, you know, so what that kind of vulnerability on that campus where you already are told routinely small ways and bigs that you don't belong there, you know, I recognize that. And it has informed a lot of my work. I want to be able to show up for my students, even if they weren't exactly the same position, a BIPOC student at a predominantly white institution. You know, and of course, I don't want to take away that you also have those experiences. You do not have to be a woman of color to have these experiences. We know that poverty is not unique in this country, you know, but there is something very unique to the experience of, you know, students of color on these campuses with the history of academia as it is. It is not an open, it, you know, we all understand its history that depends on knowledge gatekeeping. So I wanted to say that BIPOC librarians carry with this with them in a unique manner. And I know that other librarians who come from marginalized community, vulnerable communities, carry this with them as well. So it has been, since that plenary presentation 4 months ago, I just professional awe has been on my mind and how it's informed my work. And what are we gonna do to take care of ourselves so that we can ease it or give ourselves some grace, which is gonna be so necessary to give others grace. And when you're talking about just showing up the best we can, showing up as we are, we're really talking about vulnerability, right? Now, vulnerability is not how I got here. You know, being vulnerable in spaces is not a good idea for me. It hasn't been when I was in school. It wasn't in high school. It wasn't when I was looking for work, and it isn't now. Women of color do not walk into spaces and say that they don't know how to do something or that they need help. That does not serve us, and I do not operate that way. So, you know, that is my struggle. And I don't come here with an answer. I just come here really with food for thought and something that I am working through myself. And maybe it resonates with you also. I can say this, you know, I was listening to a fellow colleague the other day, and, you know, she was like, you know, there are those who will consider themselves allies. And she goes, well, says who? Who says you're an ally? Who says that you're doing the work? Who else did you check with? You know, are you simply depending on your own assessment? You know, so in order to make spaces where we can have meaningful, uncomfortable conversations that will lead to areas where we can be vulnerable, I will have to take a risk to be vulnerable at some spaces. And we will all have to take a risk to be vulnerable to say, I don't know, I'm wrong, teach me this, and reduce our defenses so that we can listen. Every day of the week, you could call me an ally to my LGBTQ sisters and brothers. But a year ago, when I was learning and understanding what it meant to add the pronouns, I was right, I'm on. Tell me what I need to do so that I can do better. But I had to be taught, and I had to be self-educated, and I had to ask others, if you think that you are a safe space for all of us to learn more and do better together, we're also going to have to question, are we actively doing that? You know, you mentioned a moment, you know, we just show up every day. There's a saying in Louisiana on the bayou called stick and move. Literally, putting your big stick, I'm sure they don't call it that, I'm clearly not from the bayou, although I lived there for many years, into the water to move your palate along, you stick and move. And it's the everyday work. Being anti-racist is not being a good person. Being anti-racist is challenging yourself every day. So I'm just here to say that it's been on my mind a lot. I'm very grateful for this discussion. I want to learn how to allow myself to be vulnerable in spaces. And I want to figure out how we can create spaces as well. So it's going to take vulnerability on both sides. It really is. And that's hard for everyone. And that's recognized as well. But there's also a lot of defense. You know, we're good people. Of course we're good people. We're librarians. We're the best people. You know, but being a good person is not going to get us there. You know, being good is not what's needed. Being challenging yourself and being uncomfortable, and I know that I'm saying things that we all know, but it's also something I'm realizing for myself, how I've had my shoulders and my shackles up, you know, for so my hackles, I think the word is, they've been up. And I'm going to have to reduce, I'm going to have to lean back a bit so I can give myself some grace and maybe make room for others. You know, it's hard to make a shift like that when it has been so successful for you and so necessary, but I don't know of an alternative. And so when we talk about, like, you know, having uncomfortable conversations to make space, to be vulnerable, I think the question is gonna have to be that just being good is not gonna cut it, and we're gonna have to be vulnerable. And that's what I've been thinking about for the last 4 months. And so I'm going to pass it along. And thank you so much for your thoughts. That was just simply tremendous. Thank you for sharing.
Okay, so I think I'm bad in cleanup. There's always a real virtue in being able to go last because I'm really moved. And also it helps me get a gauge of the room. I'm not a librarian. I'm a human scientist on a clinical trials team. And I spend a lot of time in my teaching talking about the two taboo topics of bodies and emotions. So this topic of burnout and how we work in higher ed is really relevant. Before we get into that, and even with the topics that are resonating, I just want to say I'm coming from Minneapolis. I'm from the University of Minnesota and close to the shores of Bede-Mikaska. And we acknowledge that, you know, as a land-grant university, that we are built on the traditional homelands of the Dakota and the Anishinaabe people. And especially as a land-grant university, it is vitally important to acknowledge the people whose lands that we live on, learn, and work as we seek to improve and strengthen our relationships with tribal nations. So thank you for the invitation and for letting me speak today. I'm excited about this conversation. And before I tell you a little bit about some of this work and what I've been thinking about it, the themes that really just sort of, you know, stood out for me, and I guess this is why I'm excited, is I'm hearing things about how we show up, the impact that we have on our students, you know, that it is deep, that we choose this work, right? Focusing on what's important, the passion that we have for working with young people, you know, again, not to be like a hedge fund manager, we are working with living human beings and all their complexity that they show up with in our classrooms or our offices. Decoding schooling and helping students, you know, really understand that it's a culture And that I would say too, in a lot of my work working with, you know, other professors, helping them understand that, you know, how they're teaching, the institutions they inhabit may not be, you know, a language that their students speak. In fact, Angelique, when you're talking about, there's a gentleman who works with our YMCA Equity Innovation Center that I have lunch with. We used to do it every 2 weeks before the pandemic, and we've kept it virtually. He's done a lot of our work on community, or helped with our community engagement work. And that was his experience too. You know, going into the University of Wisconsin and turning in a paper and never, ever having anyone say, you know what, this is the way we do it. And that experience is not uncommon for the students that in a large university of 60,000, you know, students, you know, that's not uncommon. And so then it begs the question of what is our role within it? And I would say as instructors, as faculty, or as people that are working with students, you know, student facing positions, that it is us. You know, it is our responsibility to take it up. It's an act of disruption and equity and transformation that needs to happen. And then the last two things I'll say that have been really, really resonant were that, you know, in these positions we have, you know, we're kind of like a bucket. And it was Ajahn Chah, who meditation teacher, some of you may be familiar with, that had said, you know, in these professions where we work with other human beings, especially when we take on, you know, whether it's their pain, their trauma, their troubles, their struggles, we become like a bucket and we get filled up with that. But we have to make sure that there's a hole in that bucket too, right? And it's that, how we have that hole in that bucket and how we can recharge, because the students will be there again and again and again, and we have to show up. How we show up matters, is vitally important. And that work is active, it's not passive. It's not an app on your phone. It's like, oh, I got another meditation app. Like, nope, it's really about doing the work day in and day out. And I think sometimes with the some of the pop culture buzz around, you know, this work, you know, it seems that you can just do it, but it doesn't tell you, well, what happens after it. It's like when you say you're sorry, right? And you realize that, okay, there's still that hurt that is there, and having to work through that. I think this is really, really important. So why I'm bringing this up is that the work that I do is really in the asking questions around the how do we operationalize this? How do we do the work? And for me, with my work in community engagement and my clinical trials team, it's about helping researchers do the internal and intrapersonal work to then show up better. You know, that it's the work that you're doing inside and how you show up. So it's, again, it's getting at that being able to notice, it's facilitating awareness that's really important. So just to give you kind of where that's going and some of the thoughts around it is that, you know, when we've seen, you know, like even the New York Times had an article on the difference between burnout and depression, and how do you tell the difference? I'm like really excited to see that there's more attention on this. You know, you hosting this conversation today, you know, there's an excellent book by Amelia and Emily Nagoski on burnout. It's fantastic. If you haven't checked it out, it's wonderful. You know, sites like the Mayo Clinic have lots about what burnout is. Great podcasts like 10% Happier. You know, because it's countering that sort of mentality that I think we see both, you know, in the private sector, where my partner works, and then in higher ed, you know, that you can just grit through it, you know, toughen up. If you're not tough enough to do 80 hours a week, you know, as an NIH-funded scientist, then you really have no business being here. You know, and there's kind of it for those of us that have been in these positions, you know, or that if we attain this level of education and being able to do it, yet we can grit through it. We may have a big enough engine, if you will. But just because our engine can continue to move forward doesn't necessarily mean that it's doing it efficiently or optimally. So you could, you know, maybe have just a couple cylinders firing, you know, it doesn't mean that it's necessarily good for you. And we need to ask some questions about it. And the other piece too, that just raises some interesting questions too, is that, you know, we may be in environments, at teams, departments, things like that, that are toxic for a whole host of reasons. And some of the, you know, kind of like the life hacks and things like this that come out, you know, assume a lot of privilege that we could just leave. Right. And if you have means, and maybe if you're, you know, like in my case, you're almost 50 and you got a bunch of academic degrees and some financial stability, sure, you can do that. But that is not afforded to many. And then, the other piece, too, is around that, you know, sometimes our environments, we may be doing deeply impactful work. And, you know, it's tending not to be all toxic or all happiness and unicorns. So how do we learn how to surf those waves? And so, you know, amidst all the kind of the pop culture pieces around, well, just do this hack, just do this piece, we really need to start to think about, well, then how do you do it? Because inevitably those things of, well, just go for a jog or just take a walk or find meditation, whatever that means, really become, you know, another sort of rock in our knapsack that is just weighing us down. And I think for those of us that are in, you know, especially in these student positions, that starts to mean as we get more and more burned out that we're not showing up well for people in front of us, well, that we start to see people as numbers or units or, you know, grades, assignments, things like that. So what I hope we can start to talk about a little bit today, and what I've found is pretty useful in some of the work that I've been doing, is getting at the reframing piece, right? That we know a lot about the body. We know a lot about how exercise or meditation can affect the brain, can affect our parasympathetic nervous system, things like that. But a lot of times the structures that we have in place are, well, exercise happens at the gym, for example, or, you know, meditation has to take place in a certain way of doing this or that. So being able to restructure that and finding those minutes, and then also getting very, very clear about what's important versus not. There is a lot that's there. I will confess to being a high functioning train wreck for the majority of my life. And these are hard lessons learned that have been complemented by, you know, by my academic work, you know, but when we think about this reframing, especially with students, you know, and we've had jump in enrollment numbers as administrators made different decisions around things for good or bad, you know, when we're with the students, understanding, well, what's important right now as a student is in front of me talking about, you know, a topic, talking about a need that they have, talking about a struggle, and being able to show up in ways that are important, that student feels heard, listened to, valued, and that they can continue to learn. So there's a lot here that I've been thinking about with these topics, and I would be more than happy to engage for a long time about this, because I love my research, but I really love my students. I'm looking forward to the questions. So lots to talk about this, and we can get into specifics around kind of stumbling your way through. So thank you for inviting me. I look forward to this discussion.
Well, thank you, Doug, Angelique, Lisa, and Jess. I know Karen has put an invitation for comments and questions, but first I wanted to just thank all four of you for your vulnerability and for sharing your stories and sharing your perspectives on this topic. You know, Jess, you talked about bringing your whole self to work and not having a zero-sum approach to all of this. Sorry, I have four pages of notes, so this is what I'm looking down at as you've been chatting. Lisa, you talked about the importance of modeling and being human. I think that's what I've taken away. Angelique, you flagged the importance of how good just won't cut it, how vulnerability is really the beginning for us to work through this as a community. And Doug, for you, as you were chatting, you know, I'm walking away with the challenge that we might have around determining what is important and what is the place to start and what isn't. I have a lot of thoughts and personal experience with this particular topic, but I will pause and send an invitation back out to everybody who's in the virtual room with us. If you have questions or comments or thoughts or scenarios, please feel free to post them in the chat. Karen and I will read out your questions. You're also more than welcome to unmute your microphone and join in on this discussion and the conversation. And that extends to all four of our guests too. So please feel free to continue this conversation with one another instead of just having Karen and me direct and lead. And I'll give us a pause, hopefully a comfortable pause, where you can reflect and take a moment to say anything you might immediately want to.
There's something that comes to mind for me. It's sort of the juxtaposition of both what Angelique and Doug talked about. I've left a toxic workplace before, and some others did too. And I certainly had a certain amount of privilege that enabled me to do that. But I watched others who didn't and still left, and of course had consequences because of that. So I just want to paint that picture for a minute and say, sometimes you have to leave a toxic situation in our workplace. It's there. There's many examples of it, and it'll make you sick, literally, from a health perspective. And I think part of what, you know, Doug, kind of what I got what you're saying, especially when we think about the privileges, you know, how do we help others who we see need to do that, right? And what kind of, you know, how do we, you know, I don't know, you can't see my hands, but, you know, like, how do you hold somebody who needs to step out of that, you know, and help them across? Like, what can we do to assist? Like, I think we do need to encourage each other to walk out of a toxic environment. Mm-hmm. And on the opposite side of that is the being vulnerable, right? Which, you know, as a trained academic and, you know, I'm a former professor too, it's like, that was not something that you were ever encouraged to do. And, you know, you were penalized for it. And being a woman in the workplace, or being a person of color, or anybody else from a marginalized group. Yet at the same time, if we stop being vulnerable, even in those environments, that's toxic to ourselves too. So they're kind of these strange, as you were talking, like, this seems, maybe it's the same side of the same coin. I was thinking it was opposite, but there's something there that is, again, the essence of, you know, what it does mean to be human, right? That is something that we bring, that is part of the makeup of who we are.
Please jump in, Doug.
Yeah, so Lisa, just maybe as a way of kicking this conversation, you know, at least in one direction, and this doesn't answer everything, but, you know, there's this really important skill that we do with our students, you know, or at least in the courses I teach, and I teach courses on meditation, the intersection with culture and knowledge, you know, where they're competing, where they complement each other, and also the mindfulness-based stress reduction. So I teach an academic version of it, so we've got more time and we can go more into the research. And, you know, as we're talking about, like, working both with students and then also with other researchers, my earlier work on teachers and burnout, and then educators and their intercultural capabilities, it's that somatic awareness, that body awareness, right? That when we've probably been in, you know, in higher ed, it's like you're in the swirl, that like just the maelstrom of minutiae that kills us, or, you know, pressing deadlines, and we can see ourselves being less and less effective, or maybe starting to, you know, dehumanize our colleagues, or, you know, all the things that we see in burnout. But being able to detect that as like almost that early warning system to be, okay, hey, you know, exhaustion is here, impatience is here. Noting that in the body, and then using that as that early warning system to say, okay, I can take a break here. That means I can walk to, you know, for my lunch, or I can go to the furthest coffee shop, or even the furthest restroom, just to get up and move and come back, can be really, really valuable. Or being able to, you know, in those meetings, knowing where, you know, our vulnerability can have a very strong back, but it can have a soft front as well, to know, okay, I'm absorbing it, but I am not moving from my position here, right? Or I'm absorbing another person's, you know, misconceptions, misinformation. But that bodily awareness can then be really useful in terms of getting us in those internal cues as we start to face outward, as well as, you know, for greater self-care.
It's funny because there's so much of this work that is in direct opposition. Everything you say and its opposite. So we want to create safe spaces, but we know that we can't create safe spaces for everyone. The best we can do is create brave spaces, and that takes work. That takes some good work, some good facilitation, some awareness of self and body and space, and coming into a space in a certain way. But we also know that some of the biggest personal growth happens when we step outside of our comfort zone. So we're in conflict in a lot of ways. Everything we say and its opposite, I think, is true. And I made a New Year's resolution with my wife this year that I was only going to, you know, deeply collaborate with people who understood nuance and didn't think of the world this black and white, yes or no. You know, you're either a good person or a bad person, because we're all both. And we all need to really spend some time sinking into context and understanding context. As you said, Angelique, make yourself vulnerable in certain situations is a very bad idea, and detrimental to you. So now you've got this world of bumper stickers coming at you, you know, you got to be vulnerable to do this work. You got to be, I'll tell you some bumper stickers. This stuff travels at the speed of trust. And that was one of the things that that I just really firmly believe, that if you come in, and it's the other bumper sticker I would put on my car is, it's sniffable. I can tell when you're just full of shit. I can tell when you're not being authentic and when you really don't care about people, when your policies don't line up with the words that are coming out of your mouth. You tell me you're really all about equitable education, but you also tell me you've got a policy about late assignments. Which is it? You tell me that you're all about humanizing students, but if I come to you and tell you my third grandparent has died, you're going to judge me. Which is it? And, you know, how are we sitting in understanding our own role in these spaces and whether we make them brave or not? It's very self-satisfying work when it's done in that smelly way. When it's done in an authentic way, as so many of you pointed out, it means discomfort. It means continuation of the work. It never ends. It's not like, oh, check that off. I did my deep thinking on Thursday at 4. Now I can go back to being, you know, patriarchal, white supremacist, fill in the blank, you know, not care about the planet, just care about profit. And I think that we wind up creating these zones of further bifurcation. Just this space, this gulf between people who want to talk about these things in a deep way and those who just aren't aware of them at all. You know, I've been doing this work for years now, and I'm struck by just how many of these 101 conversations that I keep having about diversity, about equity, and about inclusion, and how so few of the communities that I am working with are ready for those advanced conversations and the really deep stuff, digging into the ethics of it and the practice of it. And that's what we tried to do with this project, is not skirt away from the really gnarly, very difficult situations. You've got one Black student in your class, right? You've got a person with a complex disability in your class. What are you going to do? So instead of sort of saying words in a syllabus and then maybe not holding them up in the policies that are in the very same syllabus, how do you walk that talk? How do you stay consistent? How do you continue to ask questions, not just give answers to things that nobody's asked? How do you listen? And how do you show up in this way that isn't so predetermined and so reinforcing of the power dynamics that we so quickly assume? When I walk into a classroom and I put my bag on the desk, there's a lot that goes on in that millisecond. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, I'm supposed to be the knower. So, you know, one of the things that I love about these kinds of conversations is they fundamentally should change the way we think of pedagogy and fundamentally should change the way we think of ourselves as educators and who we're educating and whether or not we know who the heck we're educating. Like, have you ever educated somebody who's been a refugee? Would you know? Have you ever educated somebody who's grown up in generational poverty? Would you know? Have you ever educated somebody who didn't have money to pay the bills for, you know, their utilities that month? What would you know?
That takes me back to, you know, Doug, when you said that quote around, this is the way we do it. So much of our work is about challenging specifically that statement and really coming up, as Jess, Angelique, you and Lisa were describing, adaptable, modular, constantly changing ways of doing it. I'm going to be mindful of time, so I don't want to keep chatting. So I will pause again to see if others who are in this room want to jump in on the conversation.
Well, I don't know if anyone's hand is raised. I can't see, but I wanted to comment really as a follow-up to what was just made. You know, Even when we are here collectively doing the best work, and I feel that in my heart, this work is my professional pleasure, and it's the most meaningful part of the work I do. And even in this environment amongst like fellow education, you know, information providers and librarians, when you talk about how long have we been having these diversity 101 conversations, how long has the conversation about diversifying this profession been going on? Decades, at least 40 years, probably more, like at least maybe 40 to 50 years of a literature review would provide information on diversifying the profession and how to, you know, how to court, how to recruit, how to make them stay, you know, and our numbers aren't any better. 40, 50 years later, the numbers aren't any better. And you know, if I was not at an HBCU, and I'm not now, I am as isolated as I ever was the day I stepped on the campus of University of Virginia. And even amongst the best people, there are assumptions that I have to counter to assure everyone that I am capable of the work that needs to be done. And, you know, so I think just constantly holding ourselves accountable is really going to be the only way forward. And when I tell you that I'm trying to imagine how to make my work better, easier, more enjoyable for myself, I am still actively trying to figure out how to be vulnerable professionally, how to stop and say, I don't know this. I need help. I don't say I need help. I say, can I have an extension? I say, can I do it later? I say, can someone assist me? I have never turned down a project. Are you kidding me? You don't do that. Not if you want, you know, acknowledgement and success and confidence in the work that you can produce. So, you know, I really appreciate this discussion. I've been learning a lot about how I operate since our own plenary discussion. And again, no solutions to offer, just musings and observations. But thank you for what you're, you know, for the comment that like it does directly involve how we're going to consider and couch pedagogy as well. And the conversation is just so much bigger, you know, but I don't even know that if we are even prepared yet to even really have these conversations. Is anyone really having meaningful, uncomfortable conversations? Has anyone actually watched that happen? I haven't.
Well, we are,
yes, but outside of us. And I'm glad that we are.
I do every day because it's sort of, like you said, it's the privilege that I have of doing this work. And I mean, you probably know what this is. So I was wearing this because my hair was very floppy. I think I'm going to go for just floppy hair. Because it perpetuates so many things. I try really hard not to wear branded things when I come on a call. I just took off a hat that had a big T on it with a wave running through it. I went to Tulane University in New Orleans, and it's very different from SUNO as an institution. It's very different from the other institutions in New Orleans. It is a university that has a town gown issue, I would say, a pretty substantial one, a history like so many of the private universities. I had troubles there. I had troubles. I still have troubles. We should critique our institutions. And when I come in wearing something like that, it's worse than the bad hair that I'm carrying with me. But I think that it's these conversations and the willingness to step into that. You mentioned so many schools in New Orleans. I could have gone through this call and not said a damn thing about that hat. But this is what we found in the project, is that this stuff is here, folks. You walk into this room with a backpack on your back, every single one of you, your ancestors, your experiences, the scars, the discrimination, the positive experiences, the negative experiences, the person who cut you down and said, you don't belong here. And the person who rose, you know, held you up and said, I really like the way you read. I love that you love books. I mean, and those are those moments where we get an opportunity to call out those elephants in the room and the things, I'm mixing metaphors here. I've got backpacks and elephants, but the point is you were carrying stuff, folks. And if we don't see each other fully, if we can't have those conversations fully, then we're not doing much more than that 101 conversation. And I don't mean to say 101 isn't important. It is, but I had a really big lesson a couple of years ago where I was in yet another 101 conversation and a Black woman stood up and she said, I am so sick and tired of having to have these 101 conversations with y'all. It's time. Do it. It's your time. You got to do the work. Like, I can't be the only one here listening. And I think about her every time I think about having the 101 conversation again. And so I want to push. I want to push further and feel more uncomfortable. I want to take off my green hat. So thank you for that, Angelique. I see you. I see you're by yourself.
I see you too.
So Jess, I think that point is really important. And Angelique too, right? The one-on-one conversations that happen a lot. And that becomes that check a box, right? To get back to that authenticity spot. And our community partners smell it out. And I remember, like, you know, being able to step into it. So, like, I'm not saying our team has done it well, but the uphill battle to have, you know, 3 years where we were putting money towards sustained professional development for our team, ongoing with community partners to push that, it is a long slog that a lot of times, you know, departments aren't going, well, it's not important, but it can be done, but it takes, like, just for, you know, ballparking that, like, you're looking at years of sustained, thoughtful development if you're going to move it. And then, you know, the vulnerability, the trust, how your team's interacting with each other to build that is, it's multifaceted, it's messy, it's hard, and it takes a lot of time.
Well, thank you all for a very valuable hour together. It went by quickly, and as always, we really appreciate you joining us and being as frank and vulnerable, as reflective as you can be in this moment. I'd especially like to thank Jess, Angelique, Doug, and Lisa for talking with us today and sharing their reflections based on their roles and their context. And we will be in touch soon about office hours. And in the meantime, wish you all the very best. So thank you again and farewell.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you, everybody. Look after
you. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.